Nestled in northern Texas, Pampa is a small oil town of 15,000 people. The place is infamous for two events, its annual rodeo and a triple murder which occurred on December 31st of 1993. David Bowser, a journalist for the Daily Pampa News, was on duty that night. He will never forget those events.
It was a big story. Three people killed. And there's probably, on average, maybe one murder in Pampa during a year.
Welcomed by the sheriff, David was the first one to arrive on the scene. Hank Skinner's partner and her two sons were dead, and the crime scene was a bloody mess.
I believe that house right there, the yellow one, is where he was living, where the people were killed, or where Twyla and her one son was killed. The one that came out of the house came out the front door. This is where they found the other son. He slumped against the porch.
Everything almost the same. The kitchen is the same too.
Hank Skinner was found in a complete daze at a neighbor's home and was immediately arrested. Though he doesn't deny being in the house that night, he lived there after all, he claims that he woke up from an alcohol overdose, surrounded by bloody corpses. And though there are several major holes in this case, 12 jurors sent Hank Skinner to death row after a hasty trial. 19 years after these events, Hank Skinner is still awaiting execution in Livingston Prison, north of Houston.
You start to feel like you're dead. You can't feel anything anymore, you know, because you're subjected to sensory deprivation for so many years. The psychological toll of it begins to get to you, you know, and you feel like you can't feel anything. You, like when you pinch yourself, you just feel dead skin. You don't feel nothing.
Death row inmates are kept in solitary confinement. The process of execution takes about 10 years. Hank Skinner has been waiting twice as long.
Well, I don't accept my death. Hell no. I will fight these people until the last dying breath because I'm innocent and I didn't do this, and evidence should prove it.
Hank's execution has already been scheduled 3 times. It has been stayed 3 times. The last time he was told he was not being executed, he was in the visiting room with his wife.
Quand le directeur s'est pointé, c'était trop drôle. Hank l'a regardé, lui a dit « Qu'est-ce que j'ai encore fait ?» Parce que comme tout, tu vois, tous les maux de la terre, il lui colle sur le dos. Et le directeur l'a regardé, lui a dit « Vous avez un sursis. » Heureusement qu'il était assis, Hank. Il s'est tourné vers nous. Nous, on a poussé un cri, tu vois. Et j'ai senti toute la pression qui s'envolait de ses épaules. C'était presque comme dans un dessin animé, tu sais. T'as un truc qui fait…
In his struggle against the state of Texas, Hank Skinner relies on Sandrine. They met during one of Sandrine's visits to prison. She is a tireless activist against the death penalty and never forgets her husband's case. Time is their worst enemy.
Les dernières fois, ça a pris 2 ans et 3 ans, donc c'est difficile de savoir. Hein.
C'est infini.
Ouais, c'est vrai que moi, si je peux pas lui dire, ça va peut-être prendre 2 ans ou 3 ans, mais il le sait. Parce que lui, il peut pas se projeter sur 2 ans, 3 ans avec la vie d'enfer qu'il a dans le couloir. Il tiendra jamais.
Texas has the highest number of executions in the United States, but the legal atmosphere is changing. Since 2011, DNA testing is required for any death row inmate who did not receive it at the time of their trial. What appears to be a common sense measure was the result of a long legal struggle initiated by Rodney Ellis, a Democratic state senator from the Houston area. The bill was directly inspired by the Hank Skinner case.
Hi, how are you? Nice to meet you.
We've known each other since 1996, so it's been a long time.
Court of Criminal Appeals is slowing down that. I think statute helped a bit.
If your bill had not existed, Hank would be dead. You know this. It just. You know, I'm not blaming the judge. I'm just looking at this system and
it's hard to do. Yeah.
It can't work.
The real problem has been for far too long, too many people on the prosecution side are just trying to get another notch on the old belt, that Wild West kind of mentality. And we got to break away from that. I would hope that all of the exonerations that have come out of Texas, particularly the exonerations of people on death row, ought to really be a wake-up call to all of us to realize that there are challenges in this system.
He took a new Texas law, a ruling by the U.S. Supreme Court, and 10 years of fierce court battling for Skinner's defense team to access DNA testing. The murder weapon and dozens of other pieces of evidence had never been tested. Skinner's lawyers have had to keep fighting to have access to every detail of the case, something the Texas prosecutors have not made easy.
We have expressed concern in the course of this lawsuit about the where the evidence has been stored and what condition it's in and that's that sort of thing. And the state's response to that has been very aggressively to push back. They did not want to have to reveal in this lawsuit where the evidence is or what condition it's in or what they've been doing with it.
Defending death row inmates requires self-sacrifice. It's a painstaking, time-consuming process. The defense is often done with few resources, and victories are rare. The Hank Skinner defense case represents 19 years of procedure, several lawyers, and many judges. Robert Owen, Hank Skinner's lawyer, experienced it firsthand.
There are more than 16,000 pages of documents here. There's an awful lot of paperwork associated with Mr. Skinner's case.
Today, Rob writes another appeal for the Hank Skinner case. It has become a familiar routine.
The courts have found ways to interpose technical legal issues between themselves and that fundamental question of whether Hank is innocent or guilty.
It's an understatement to say that the Texas juries like to convict the accused. After his arrest, Hank Skinner was defended poorly. The pretrial criminal investigation was sloppy and hasty. Like many death row prisoners, Skinner's real defense began after the trial.
What is more important, okay, finality or accuracy? Which is more important? In other words, I say to you, hey man, the jury convicted you, I don't give a damn what happened after that, I'm going to kill you. And somebody says, hey, you know, you've tested some of this evidence and it's proved that this guy might not have done this, so why don't we test this evidence, let's make sure we got the right guy here before we kill him, you know? No, we don't want to do that, let's just kill him.
Without David Protes, Hank Skinner would have been dead a long time ago. With the help of his students, Professor Protes, who was the director of Northwestern University's Innocence Project, resumes investigations abandoned by the criminal justice system. His work already exonerated 5 death row prisoners. Today, David Protes has an important announcement to make to his students. Hank Skinner has been granted DNA testing on the last pieces of evidence, including the murder weapon.
Rather long one, even by Hank's standards. It says, hey man, underlined, we won, exclamation marks. This truly is a victory for Hank and Sondren, but it's also a victory for the legal team. It's a victory for your reporting efforts. It's a collective victory for justice.
After years of research and numerous trips to Texas, David Protes' students have found previously unknown witnesses and have succeeded in reopening Hank Skinner's case.
Kayla, I'm wondering if you could sort of tell people where you left off in the reporting and just have a brief discussion of whether you think there is anything more to be investigated in Hank's case.
One really good interview that I participated in was with Twyla's daughter, Lisa, who is still living in Pampa. And from that interview, a couple things stood out. One, that Twyla and her uncle like often got into arguments.
For David and his students, as well as for the defense and the media, the victim's uncle has become the prime suspect in the case. But the prosecution in Texas keeps ignoring them.
In our country, when officials conduct investigations, they whitewash. They cover up the truth. They justify what the previous officials had done. Instead of that, we had 22-year-old journalism students going to Texas into real communities in the real world to find the real truth.
The Hank Skinner case is disturbing. The district attorney, who has doggedly tried to have him executed for years, carefully avoids answering any questions. The legendary Southern hospitality does not apply to death row. Journalist David Bowser knows all the parties in this case. He got in touch with the investigators, the judges, and the forensic experts. But nobody wants to rehash the Hank Skinner case.
It was such a traumatic thing. People kind of, you know, they're tired of hearing about it too. So, but it's such a big story that, you know, we definitely keep an eye out for it. State like Texas, everybody's pretty much solid on where they stand on the death penalty. You know, not necessarily sure whether I agree or not.
David Bowser also considers the Hank Skinner case closed.
I think he probably did it, but you know what I think doesn't matter. What a jury and court came up with.
During the trial, Hank Skinner was portrayed as having a dark side. Alcohol abuse and a disorderly life sealed his fate. In Pampa, this reputation has not gone away. The commonly held belief is that Skinner is guilty.
I don't know. I don't know what brought it about or nothing, but I do, for a fact, know that he did kill Twala and the two boys.
Now, I know they're supposed to just execute him in November. I don't know if that's still going to happen.
Probably not.
He'll come up with some excuse.
Try to blame someone else for it. And we didn't go for that.
No.
At all.
Let's talk about the case. Let's talk about the forensics. Let's talk about the evidence. Oh no, nobody wants to talk about that because it proves me innocent. All they want to talk about is, oh, you had a bad reputation, you were a bad person, blah, 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 blah. Hey man, I'm not here to be character assassinated. You know what I'm saying? My private life is my business. What's relevant here is whether I killed three people or not. If I didn't, it doesn't matter if I drank up half the town. I deserve to be let out of here so I can go drink up the other half.
Hank Skinner has already been to Huntsville twice. The last time his sentence was reprieved was just after he finished his final meal, a few minutes before his execution. Since the U.S. re-established the death penalty in 1977, more than 500 Texas prisoners condemned to death have not been so lucky. Texas maintains that the death penalty is effective. During a Republican presidential debate, the governor of Texas issued a passionate defense for capital punishment in response to a provocative question.
Governor Perry, a question about Texas. Your state has executed 234 death row inmates, more than any other governor in modern times. Have you struggled to sleep at night with the idea that any one of those might have been innocent?
No, sir, I've never struggled with that at all. The state of Texas has a very thoughtful, clear process in place. They get a fair hearing. They go through an appellate process. They go up to the Supreme Court of the United States if that's required. If you kill one of our children and you kill one of our citizens, you will face the ultimate justice in the state of Texas, and that is you will be executed.
We heard it live. He had a captive audience, okay? They were all Republicans. And Republicans have problems, you know, their asshole squeaks when they walk, and that's one of their problems. And the other problem is they don't believe in substance. They think process triumphs over substance. They're not worried. Their first question is never, what is this? It's, what can we say about this? You know, they say, oh yes, we're going to give you a fair trial, and then we're going to take you out here to this tree and hang your ass. They don't care, you know.
The death penalty is declining in the United States. In fact, six states have abolished it in 6 years. But in Texas, the police and the criminal justice system maintain the traditions of law enforcement from the Old West.
You know, Texas is, you know, number one on the death row, you know, death penalty. I think we're getting the message across that, you know, don't mess with Texas.
After more than a decade working on her husband's case, Sandrine is appalled by the American criminal justice system.
C'est un vrai choix politique. À partir du moment où tu es étiqueté, que tu sois dans le couloir de la mort, que tu sois en prison, tu n'as plus de droits. Tu es considéré comme un déchet de la société. Et après, on va effectivement dire au public, regardez, ils ont accès à des appels, etc. Mais c'est faux. Si tu n'as pas les moyens d'être bien défendu au départ, une fois que tu es prisonnier de ce système pour en sortir, mais c'est quasi impossible.
Large demonstrations against capital punishment are unusual in the United States. But the last days of Troy Davis were an exception. Accused of the murder of a white policeman 20 years ago, his innocence had become obvious. For this reason, he became one of the faces of judicial error.
Help us in the name of Jesus, help us, please.
For once, the American people were holding their breath, waiting for a last-minute reprieve. After a moment of intense suspense, the state of Georgia executed Troy Davis by lethal injection in 2011. Talking about abolishing the death penalty to American people isn't easy, especially when two-thirds of the population are in favor of it. However, John Holbrook presents his picture of death row prisoners all over the country. Today he's in Dallas, celebrating the Mexican Day of the Dead.
Some of these people are very obviously guilty of the crimes that they're condemned for, and some of them have big innocent claims. You know, they put them in a little box for 23 hours a day, and then for that extra hour, they put them in another box.
I'm claustrophobic.
Oh, well,
there's
yeah.
There's no way I can live in a box.
I can't imagine the...
It's just...
Yeah, yeah.
That's torture in itself.
It's torture, yeah. It's a topic that is not listened to. It's the media doesn't address it. Politicians don't address it. It's an evil that exists that's unexplained. When you start talking about the facts, people stop listening, you know, immediately. Well, I believe that art is the only way to communicate. To bring my photographs to this artistic tradition, the tragedy of it all is seen so much more clearly in the Day of the Dead. You know, we might as well celebrate their death now because they're walking dead.
John is an artist. He also works as a private investigator. Frustrated by the Texan criminal justice system, he has agreed to help us find the jurors involved in Hank Skinner's trial.
The district attorney, the man who condemns people to death, is elected to position, okay? So in order to become elected to position, you have to have a certain degree of celebrity. So these rock star district attorneys like slam dunks, you know, because it makes them look good. And every year, in order to become elected over the last guy, you've got to be tougher on crime. So every year, this brutality is ratcheted up a little bit more every election. Hello. Hi, Mr. Williams.
Yes, sir.
I'm John Holbrook, sir. How are you today?
Fine, Jerry Williams.
I'm an investigator licensed with the state of Texas, or more accurately, a private investigator. And I'm working on a case involving the pending execution of one Hank Skinner that you may remember.
Okay.
If I'm not mistaken, you were one of the jurors that presided in this case in 1995, is that right?
Yes, sir. You got these people in the courtroom, the attorneys and the judges and all. No matter what the evidence is, you got to go with what you're told.
For the first time in front of a camera, a juror involved in the Hank Skinner case admits that if he was given the choice again, he would not sentence Hank to death.
The evidence that we were given, obviously all of us came up with the same thing, same end result, but, you know, now that I'm hearing all this other stuff, I don't know, you know. What do you think?
Eventually, the DNA tests are entrusted to a laboratory chosen by the state of Texas. The first test results are in. Hank Skinner's DNA has been found everywhere in the house. The Attorney General of Texas boasts about it and maintains that the results incriminate Hank Skinner even more. According to Professor David Protes, nothing is easier than manipulating DNA tests to make them tell your side of the story.
I think that some of the results are not good for him because his DNA is found, for example, on the knife and on the carpet. But that's not entirely surprising because Hank doesn't dispute being in the home the night of the crime. And he doesn't dispute using the knives to prepare foods. What is very significant in the first wave of testing is that someone else's DNA was also found on the murder weapon.
To justify this unknown DNA profile, only one piece of evidence represented hope for Skinner's side. It was a blood-stained jacket, which belonged to neither the victims nor Hank. Today, the jacket is missing. It's been lost by the authorities.
The piece of evidence that is clearly the most important piece to telling us the truth of what happened in that house in Pampa, that horrible New Year's Eve, is gone. It's, to me, outrageous. It's criminal that the state of Texas did not properly preserve that evidence, and it may cause us to never know what ended up happening that night.
C'est un battant, mais on a tous un point de retour, et il est extrêmement usé quand même. Donc, il mène tellement une vie d'enfer jour et nuit que je me dis mais comment il fait pour tenir quoi? Comment il dégoupille pas?
The state of Texas has allowed the evidence to be tested by an independent laboratory, all at the expense of the defense.
Ce que je veux, ce pourquoi je me bats, c'est qu'ils sortent, c'est qu'on soit ensemble. Je sais plus, il y a un journaliste qui me posait la question, je lui ai dit non, mais attendez, mais moi je fais pas de l'accompagnement de fin de vie, hein. Ça m'intéresse pas du tout. C'est mon mec et je veux qu'il sorte de là, quoi. Je veux qu'on ait la vérité et je veux qu'il sorte et qu'on puisse commencer à vivre.
One night, man, it just went to shit, and I mean, to this day, when I wake up and I start thinking about it, I just can't understand it, you know what I'm saying?
So you have to realize the nature of the beast. You got to realize what you're fighting. You're fighting an uphill battle. And so, you know, I just try to take it one day at a time, remain calm, and see what happens, right?
See you. So I'm drinking some George Jones.